I've certainly been in front of a lot of folks, and I love to talk about the things we've done together, both as a community, but this is a special time. This is our first Anaconda conference, and it has a very important difference from some of the other community conferences we've done. And the purpose of this conference is you. The purpose is to enable you to solve some really important challenges the world's facing. We built Anaconda, and I've been working on some of these problems, as Dwayne mentioned, kind of in nights and weekends and in spare time when I might have been doing something else. Because I care so much about it. I'm a scientist by trade, and kind of got addicted to the programming bug and to the making tools bug kind of along the way. But I still love the data science. I still love inverse problems, machine learning, artificial intelligence. I still love those problems. So I've been looking forward to maybe the next few months, few years, actually spending more time on that. Now that we've hired a new CEO, some of you heard that news. I used to be the CEO, sold it to about a month ago, and so I'm still in that process of transition. We hired someone new to help lead Anaconda and lead Continuum Analytics. I'm really excited about that. But today I'm gonna talk about, and actually we had notes on one of these. I thought we were gonna have my notes on one of these. Can that be fixed? one of them didn't show my notes. I wanna find out if you've had a good time. Have you met somebody here? Clap your hands if you've met somebody new. Great. Raise your hand if you've learned something new. Fantastic. That's excellent to see. Now, did you have an idea about how to make your work better? Clap if you had an idea about how to make your work better. And let's clap, because I want to clap and recognize all the people here who make that possible. What thrills me about Continuum more than anything is the ability to bring bright people together and give them time to work on important technologies that can benefit the world. It's something I've cared about for a long time. I've been trying to figure out for a long time. How do we actually build a company that can spend dedicated resources to promote and build open source? It's important. As you think about this year's conference, realize we're going to do this again next year. We're going to have an AnacondaCon 2, pop. It'll be awesome. It'll be in April, sometime in April next year. We haven't quite finalized the date, but it'll be in April. So think about who you're going to bring next time with you. You want to make sure some of your colleagues, your people you know, come and benefit from this event as well. Also, maybe propose a talk. You can actually come, and if you have something meaningful, an industry or something you're doing at work, something you're doing in your spare time that's very interesting, propose a talk, and we'll do that too. And encourage your employer to sponsor the conference, sponsor one of our support offerings, sponsor us, become a subscriber to Anaconda Enterprise, or take advantage of some of our training or consulting. These are important ways that you support and sustain the mission that I've been a part of for now, it's coming on 20 years. Do I have a clicker? I don't think I got the clicker. Is it over here? Okay, thanks. All right, there we go. So Anaconda is open data science. That's one of the things I think we've been talking about deeply is open data science, how it's changing the world. But Anaconda brings all these tools together, and lets us do data science together. But more importantly, it's actually about community. And together, as a community, we're already having a big impact. I saw this slide just a little while ago. It's work from Jean-François Puget from IBM, and he did this search that I've done a few times. It's a search on Indeed looking for jobs. You're comparing machine learning or data science against several languages. And you see that on the left, you can see on the right, you can see this graph, and this graph is showing the jobs have been increasing in this space, kind of around the time that Anaconda downloads have been increasing. The correlation is obvious, but obviously correlation doesn't mean causation. Who knows what's causing one or the other? But I'd like to think that we've been having an impact on this space, especially as you look at the Python curve growing even faster. But it's just beginning. As we heard from Hillary, data and applications are going to remake our world. So we're having a big impact together. How do we keep having an impact? The data deluge is just beginning. How can we, as a community of Anaconda users, keep helping to find solid foundations to build solutions on top of? How do we turn the data deluge today into better life for ourselves, for our children, and even our grandchildren? How do we do that? That's what drives me. That's what I'm excited about. We should all be considering how we can use this technology to further our particular domain of the world that we understand. Data is going to keep growing. There's an explosion happening around us. Here's a few sources of increasing data. We all have carrying around in our pockets a cell phone. We've got tablet data. Think of the videos that are being stored on Amazon Cloud Drive. It's now unlimited if you have Prime account. You can keep just storing videos and photos. And we've already seen what some of those cloud providers are doing with that, doing automatic recognition of images, automatic recognition of who you are, do searches. It's amazing to see what's happening. Sensors are collecting everything. It's just continuing to grow. We have mobile phones growing. Internet of Things is just going to explode upon us. It's starting to creep, but cars, our phones, our refrigerators, our toasters, the cars, the future of self-driving cars is very exciting. But think of the data that's going to happen. All the data coming from our gyms, our playgrounds, our everything else. I think those systems can likely be built using Anaconda. That's why we build Anaconda. Those systems that connect the Internet of Things can be built using Anaconda. That's what drives me to make a better Anaconda. Now, I studied biomedical imaging at the Mayo Clinic years ago. That's where SciPy was born. This is where I had a fascination with images, and I wanted to make fast processing available to people in the Python ecosystem. But the quantified self, image processing, diagnostic that Hillary showed, I saw that before and was really impressed. People have been talking about that for 20 years, how it's going to replace radiology. It'll take a little time, believe me. I understand a little bit how those processes work in medicine. But eventually, they'll get help and they'll be able to process more and more, and people who are less well off in the world will be better because of data and because of advanced analytics. I'm excited about that. Social media exploding. There's 1.5 billion tweets a day, 1 billion pieces of content shared each day on Facebook, 500 million users of Facebook in a social graph. These are approximate numbers. They change regularly. You are being commoditized as your tweets and your posts get shared and processed and analyzed. All this is happening. Scientific data, of course, astronomy, satellite imaging, big physics. The scientists have been processing large data for a long time, so that's been very exciting. I started my career as a scientist, and they've been processing that data for a long, long time. The convergence is happening faster and faster. Then, of course, there's business data, customer information. A lot of you probably deal with a lot of that, and some of you deal with some of the scientific data as well. Model for your business, financial, you want to figure out where customers are, how to sell to them better, but you want to figure out how to profit better from your finances. There's a huge variety here, and this is actually where some of the challenges are, processing that variety and connecting it. But don't forget about the dark data. Dark data includes the CSVs and Excel files and the doc files and all this unstructured data, some structured, some semi-structured, all over your hard disks. How do you search that? How do you find it? Those are the kind of problems we want to make it easy for Anaconda to solve. So a lot of people, of course, the standard answer is build your data lake. And for a lot of people, it looks about like this. It's nice in a country town. It's nice. There's a little boat ramp, no roads. You might go there on weekend and vacation a little bit, but you're not really gonna get many insights out of it very quickly. That's a nice quaint picture. You might visit on the weekend, but there aren't any software connection highways to really run analytics trucks on. So the Anaconda platform actually helps. And hopefully this week, past few days, you've started to see how that's possible. This is the way I see Anaconda. I see Anaconda connecting to all data, wherever it comes, whether it's HDFS, it's a storage format, one of the relational database vendors, whether it's sitting on IBM mainframes, whether it's sitting on files across S3. Wherever the data is, we want to make it easy to get and easy to think about as a scientist, as a data scientist, as a practitioner, so that you can build applications, dashboards, workflows, microservices. Those can be built easily, pain-free, and get insights, decisions, actions, results, and creations can come off of that. So all these data deliverables can be built using Anaconda. That's the goal. That's the goal we have. That's the goal we're trying to help you solve your problems with. Reaching the full potential of a data-driven world means reaching our full potential as an Anaconda community. How do we do that? There's a couple of things. I'm going to go, I'll focus on a few of these, go quickly through some of the others. Here's a list of five. There may be others. These are five that came to mind as I thought about how do we reach our full potential with Anaconda so that we can reach our full potential as an open data science community. Make code to data connections seamless and easy. We all know we need to bring code to data. Data's got gravity, it's got mass, it's going to sit where it is. How do I write my code and then have it just pull the data as necessary and not do it when it's not necessary? How do I do that? We're getting better, but there's still a long way to go. We need to amplify our learning. We know that there's a lot of learning needs to take place. We need to shrink the time between an idea and production. And I'll talk about each of these in more depth. Choose the right algorithm for your data and the question. Hillary gave a great talk about some exciting ways and exciting algorithms that are on the forefront. And it's important not to get too distracted by the latest algorithm of the day. It's important to learn about them, learn what can be applied to your data, but recognize that no magic algorithm exists. And then cultivate and participate in the community mission. Come together, do things with others, share your results. So first thing, code to data, how do we do that? Data silos are everywhere, we know that. Most of the problems we faced, as I spoke earlier with the folks from IBM, a lot of problems in business are placed by the data silos. They're sticking in one database or another, and I kind of merge these data together to really get the insights I'm looking for. So bringing that together is helpful. A lot of times it's just putting Python in the ETL, in the extract, transform, load pipeline, so you can get the data back and forth, is how Python has become very dominant in data science. But that same data often, even with the even more fundamental than the data silos, is that same data has to be stored in memory twice or three times. Why? Because there are not a common way to talk about data that's common among languages. So we've spent 40 years trapped in our language type silos as well. And the Blaze project is working to solve this. There are other projects that it's related to that are out there that we're looking forward to cooperating with. So Blaze, just to remind you, it's still a project we're working on deeply. It was one of the founding technology concepts that Peter and I, as we talked about co-founding Continuum, the thing we wanted. We wanted to make it easy for anyone, anywhere, to write an expression in Python, connect it to whatever data source, and have that expression compiled to a runtime. One of the things that we clearly understood as we got going with the project is it's a big problem, it's a hard problem, and it really needs the separation of expression, data, and runtime. And there's actually work to do on the runtime still. And so a lot of the work we've done recently has been on Numba Dask, improving the scalability of the runtime of Python so that the Blaze expressions would have somewhere to go that's very, very useful in the Python ecosystem. Blaze expressions can also go to any other kind of runtime system, whether it's Spark or Hive or Impala or Kudu or whatever. That's one of its powers. You no longer have to be somebody who understands only one way to write data. And very coupled, and a very important part of Blaze, is actually the data shape concept. Put here very briefly, look it up. I'll talk about this at technical conferences in more depth. But it helps you to explain data. It's like a schema for everything. So that you can, but not necessarily semantic web, not that. It's able to just put type next to a data set, serve that up over URL so that your code can recognize what it is, and then as the code gets moved to the runtime, process it correctly. one of the things I'm very excited about, especially in my new role, I might have a little more time. We're looking for funding still to do this, however. I really have a vision for the future of array computing that I want to push for Python 3. I put NumPy 2.0 in, it's really a question mark, because that's a community decision what happens to NumPy 2.0. I want to make that very clear. However, I'm excited about building new technologies that take the concepts of NumPy that I know and love and move them, separate them, so that you can have orthogonal pieces of work. So the very start is a type system. That type system then connects to a generalized function, a multiple dispatch mechanism to have specialized runtimes that run against this generalized type system. Basically, it's the core part of this, the UMath modules, the UFunc modules. We heard about how Intel's improved many of those. Have that separated from even from then the memory view. Then anything, whether it's a memory view or a Python array, but what's especially exciting is how this will enable cross-pollination between multiple languages. So you can start breaking down those silos of language. I have some libraries in R, some libraries in Scala, some libraries in Python, Node. They can talk to each other and not have to copy data back and forth to talk to each other. They can actually just call one right after the other on the same data set, and that's the concept of data fabric. Talk to more about that in depth later. That's just showing the kinds of things I'm excited about and the things that are necessary for us to make progress against the siloization of code and data. So another very important thing that has to take place is amplification of learning. One study said we have 190,000 projected shortage of data scientists. Now, we don't know what that is exactly. One of the reasons for the shortage, we're not quite sure how to define one. But I think the underlying principle is correct, which is we don't have enough people with enough knowledge and enough awareness of all the pieces that are necessary. Now, some of the solution is better tools. So take domain experts and give them better tools so they can have what they need. And then that's part of the solution. That's one of the things we're working on. Another part of the solution is to train, to really work at helping people cover that gap from where they are to the skills they need to do the work that's necessary. That's very important to us. We've partnered with DataCamp. They're here in the audience. Some of them are maybe here in the audience. You may have seen them back in the booth. They were a great sponsor of Anaconda. We partnered with Galvanize to help do those initial boot camp trainings as well. And then we have our own Anaconda Skills Accelerator program. This program is intended, it's a postgraduate program, basically. It's come do an internship with us, work on a project, and then you can move forward. And I'll talk a little bit about that in a second. The key to amplifying learning, though, is that you have to recognize you're still learning. That's actually an important value at Continuum. It's something that I try to remember all the time. Sometimes we think you can't teach old dogs new tricks. So as you get older, you're going to stick in your old SAS approach. You're going to stick with your old languages. You're going to stick with your old approach. You don't want to learn something new. Brain plasticity research has shown that you actually can still learn, even into old age. But it does depend on practice, doing some things, having some new initiatives. So you can learn new things, and in fact, by learning new things, you can change the world. Just by learning one or two things differently, you connect with something, and you can bring information that the people who may know that thing you're learning don't have. And with that, I heard a great example of this from a colleague who talked about how he knew a use case, he learned a particular mathematical principle, and together could basically solve an important problem in fluid dynamics that hadn't been solved for a long time. So amplify learning means effort on your part. I love this quote by Michelangelo. I'm still learning. Michelangelo is a brilliant Renaissance man, and at 87, he was still learning. All of us, I think, are doing the same. So our approach into that learning of the particular to help solve the data science shortage is really what we call our skills assessment program. This is a formal postgraduate independent study program with on-the-job learning. We work with people. They get to mentor. It's something I care deeply about. I want to see people learn to use the tools in a way that is best beneficial to the business problems at hand. So we work with them to improve their science, their data engineering, their quantitative programming skills. Let me know if you want to enroll or if you have some need for someone like this. We kind of both edges of that coin have to connect in order to continue the program. We also, of course, do our own on-site training. This Anaconda on-site training is connected to data science, it's connected to the kinds of workflows that we've seen. We have both entry classes as well as deep dive science classes. So just want to make sure that typically it's with groups and teams. We have a fleet of about 7 really, really talented trainers. I'm really excited about this. Someday, you know, if I retired right now, probably what I'd do is I'd go into curriculum, like really trying to help education improve. I guess that's maybe as you learn a lot, you realize the kind of things that could have been done a little better. Like one of the things is, there's a great TED talk that actually talks about how we teach math to too many people, which is odd, right? I love math, and I thought, what are you talking about? But what they're talking about is we teach calculus to people that never really need it. And they actually should probably learn logic instead, maybe by playing games in high school instead of just reading, trying to do analysis. Now, if you're an engineer and you want to do machine learning, then you better learn calculus. Because in fact, not only calculus, you want to learn multivariable calculus. One of the problems, how many have taken multivariable calculus in this room? So a lot of you here, because this is a group of scientists, right? How many people have used divergence and curl? Yeah, the fluid dynamics folks and a couple of electromagnetic folks are in the room doing that, right? I love divergence and curl. It was awesome. I love that course. However, what I've recognized is there's a real need for partial derivatives and gradients and multivariable analysis that people don't get because they're sort of have to be taught divergence and curl too. Now, some of the engineering classes do, but if you look at the deep learning optimization algorithms, you gotta learn a gradient, you gotta learn what that is, and really it's connected to linear algebra. So there's some improvements we can make to how we teach that. Computing literacy, array-oriented concepts are critical. Object-oriented is great, there's some really great use cases for it. Array-oriented is critical for data processing, for advanced analytics, and it's often underappreciated and underemphasized concepts that are taught. Table-oriented is another way they talk about that. The column-oriented data stores people talk about, just a corollary of the array-oriented concepts that are so important. Basic data structures, basic algorithms. Then I found a website called brilliant.org that I really love, so I put a link to it there. Try it out, especially for a young person trying to understand what they should learn about. It's a great thing to do on the weekends if you have kids like me who get subjected to their dad talking about math all the time. So this one is one I really care deeply about, but you've just spent the past few days learning how to do this. So I'm just going to reemphasize how the Anaconda Enterprise Platform and Anaconda and the enterprise tools on top of that, the whole goal, one of the goals of the platform is to shrink the time from idea to production. You recognize that's an iterative thing. You recognize you're going to have to do it more than once. You do it once, that's great, but you're going to have to do it again because you're going to learn something, and there's a feedback loop there. Right? So you want to make that sure that process is very, very fast. When I came to Python, one of the first things I loved was how quickly I could iterate because it was interpreted. So I could grab objects, and I could quickly iterate. I didn't have to compile, wait for a while, lose track of my train of thought, figure that out. So iteration is the key to success, rapid iteration. So how do I shrink that time? I did a production, collaboration, automation, common platforms. So you've spent a few times learning this. That's a lot of why the 5.x platform is the way it is. So if you haven't seen a demo, haven't looked at what's there, definitely encourage you to take a look. Take a look at what's there that really speeds up the time from idea to production. Now, write algorithms. This is an area that I really love. I'm not going to bore you with too much detail. There's a few math equations here, mostly just because I'm still an old tech guy who has to put some math in every one of my presentations. You've got to make sure you have the right algorithms. And it's very easy, especially in today's world, to get distracted by the latest craze. You see one example, and it's fine to apply that and look at it. But really, you want to make sure you understand the high level. And here's one example of the learning space. There's supervised learning, unsupervised learning. Scikit-learn is really a great library, not only because of its tools, because if you want to understand machine learning, a lot of times just looking at it and its table of contents and its tutorial and it's just what's there, you can learn a lot and give you a very high-level perspective. And it's important, it helps give you a balanced view on what, you know, not, I don't just need one library to do all my modeling and my prediction. It's really about understanding the art. So supervised learning, very simple. You have a function, basically. It's a big nonlinear functional, and the training is estimating the parameters of that model. That's the way I see it, because I used to teach inverse problems, used to teach people how to estimate thetas from equations just like this. So I think deeply about that. But there's a lot of tools that make that easy. Of course, neural networks are all the rage, deep learning. You've got these hidden models. I see that as basically just one larger nonlinear model. There's some really important things about it. You can see why it's useful. A lot of the world seems to be hierarchical, seems to be multi-resolution hierarchical, and so a hierarchical nonlinear, general-purpose nonlinear model seems to fit as long as you have enough data to justify estimating all those parameters, all those weights, because you're still estimating a whole bunch of weights there. It's just the same supervised learning, or you can also use it in an unsupervised learning fashion if you put the outputs, you make the thing you're training against, the input itself. Then you're doing a data reduction. But at the end of the day, you have this big model and a few parameters. If you don't have enough data, it's not going to be useful for you. So you have to really understand the scope of your algorithms. In fact, there's a nice Netflix video. I don't know if anyone's seen this this gentleman from the UK who writes this, The Secret Tales of Modern Thinking and Algorithms. I'm not saying it has all the algorithms that you'll care about. But what it does do, as you watch that show, it kind of reinforces there's not a magic solution to your problem. There's ways of thinking and ways of understanding that you can learn from. And if you apply those right ways of thinking and understanding to your problem, if you're lucky to find them or you have a colleague who points you in that direction, you can really do something interesting. But I'm excited about some of the technologies we've been building that help with these right algorithms. In particular, I just want to give this a simple example. A couple of weeks ago, I got a chance to process data myself for the first time in a few months. And I had the Ashley Madison Hack database. Don't worry, I didn't search for anybody here. I didn't do a cross-correlation against the attendees at AnacondaCon, so no worries. If you want me to, let me know. There was 2,000 CSV files of credit card transactions, 9 million records in that data set. So I couldn't just pull it all into memory. It was too big on my laptop. I needed more machines, so I had to use some kind of parallelism. So how do I do this? Well, ultimately, with a little help from my friends at Continuum, a little help from Matt, a little help from Martin, a little help from Jeff Reebok, actually, we ended up able to use Read CSV to actually read all the data into one big, gigantic data frame, repartition it down from 2,000 partitions, the number of CSV files, to 100, and then do a resample. I was really excited I could set the index on that distributed data frame so I could then do a very fast resample over 1 month and calculate the mean and produce a plot. So very quickly, I can take that 9 million records of CSV files with about, you know, a few lines of Python code, and quickly, in a few minutes, it actually ended up being, once we did the repartition correctly, it was about 10 seconds of computation time, and get this plot, which shows apparently there's some activity at Ashley Madison between 2014 and 2015. So Dask feels really modern. So when we talk about right algorithms, I really want to encourage people here to try some of the things we've been working on intentionally to support the Python ecosystem and help you solve your problems better with Anaconda. And Dask definitely feels modern. I can speak from experience at this point. And it's flexible parallelism. And then what I'm excited about is connecting it to all the problems around machine learning, advanced analytics and modeling, advanced data munging. All of those are an import away in the Python ecosystem that's full of so many great things. The last topic I want to spend a little bit of time about, it's probably the most important aspect of Anaconda that's necessary for us to realize in order to really reach the potential we all have. And that's cultivating and enhancing the Anaconda community. The first concept I want people to understand is that community really starts with the passion of a few individuals. And that's true, I think, throughout history. It's true here. You all experience that in your own life. You kind of see people get excited about something, and they get so excited, they push on it. And they work really hard, often nights and weekends, often really late, kind of stay up at nights, figure that out. It really is small groups are what build things, what create things. And it's really a human limitation, because the bandwidth of communication necessary to communicate at that level in order to create something new is really small. So it always starts with a focused person that's essential. And then from there, it kind of grows. And I want to illustrate this process of going from a single focused individual or group of individuals to a larger community. And I want to use an example from Continuum in the Conda and the Anaconda teams. So I've seen this happen a lot. I saw this with NumPy, I saw this with SciPy, I saw this with Numba, I've seen this with Conda, I've seen this with Anaconda. This is a sort of a pattern. And then I've studied other projects out there as well. It's a pattern that shows up quite a bit, and it's often talked about the bus number on a project. You know, is there enough people to maintain that project if the people involved disappear? And so that's been one thing I've cared deeply about, is how do we support those people? But here's two, this doesn't show everything associated with a project, but this is the GitHub repository contributions of Conda and Anaconda. And you can see there's a few names there. You probably can't read them from the back, but I'll show the pictures of some of the players here on the next slide. You've got Elon Schnell, obviously being very active for a long period of time on the Conda side and the Anaconda side. Got Brian, Aaron Muir plugging in. And of course, recently, Kel Franz has come in, done tremendous work around Conda and improved it and added to that community. But it's and then the contributor list, actually, if I showed you the full contributor list to Conda, it's 120 people. So there's 120 different people who have added something to Conda. Anaconda is our internal package recipes. You can see that's the activity there. So there's people that make a big difference to start with. And then those people, they basically are other people come. They come and then are part of that larger community. And a really important transition is actually going from the original effort that was spent by the person involved, the nights and weekends, the 6 months, the time spent on SciPy, not graduating from Mayo Clinic, so my wife was still at home with our three kids and wondering what I was doing. Hi, honey. and wondering why I didn't get tenure because I was spending time on NumPy. Like, that's effort. It's real effort, right? And so it's good to be appreciated. It's good to say thank you for that effort, and it's good to tell people thank you for that effort. But for the community to flourish, it's also important for that transition to happen so that it becomes not my project. It becomes not me. It becomes me giving to a community, and it becomes everybody participating. And then there's new people to thank. There's new people to thank for the work they do. And so, you know, here's right now the folks that are cultivating the Anaconda team at Continuum. Crystal's, you saw her with the product manager. She's leading a larger team of people that are making this happen. And it's an important illustration. You'll find evidence of that everywhere. And a lot of times, the reason I share this story is because each of you can make a difference by just little things. Saying thank you to somebody, expressing appreciation for the work they've done, and then also helping them express appreciation to the new people that come in and provide additional work. These are important to keep a community flourishing. And then as more people come, then there needs to be more standards about how we treat each other. Large communities of people, it's well known, you can take offense sometimes, right? There's things we can say that bother each other, right? We have different points of view. We have different ways of looking at the world. And the more people that we get, the more that can strengthen us to have all that diversity. Because we have lots of ways to think. That means we avoid these little local minima. We can be sure we're solving a bigger problem. But then codes of conduct really, really help. So the Python community has a great example of a code of conduct for a large community of folks. Some open, considerate, respectful. Very useful to follow that. Diversity is important, and diversity takes some work. I love this quote from the Red Shoe Movement, which is a movement trying to encourage women in particular areas of industry. But this quote is from Andreas Tapia: diversity is the mix. Inclusion is making the mix work. It's one thing to have people all together. It's another thing to put some effort into it. And you really do. That's one thing I've definitely learned. Diversity is easy to think. If you don't have the diversity, you get into groupthink. And making sure you don't get in there takes some effort. And you have to be intentional about it. Finally, I'm going to end with just three quick slides that talk about kind of some principles of community that are really critical. Actually, there's one more, especially for this audience. These are old principles about how communities really work together. And philia is a great Greek word about sisterly and brotherly love. It's about caring, doing well for someone for their own sake and not because of what you're going to get out of it, right? That's critical to have people feeling that way in order to have a community thrive. Seva, another great word. It's a Sanskrit word meaning selfless sacrifice, meaning volunteering for the community. Helping out is not a special skill. All of us can do it. We all have done it. Everyone here is doing it in some part of your community. And I like this word, thika. It's the Arabic word for trust, belief, confidence. It's believing, take a risk with somebody, and join with them in the mission they're trying to accomplish to build something useful and important. I love this quote from Charlie Munger. He gave it at a USC law firm. It's about the highest form a civilization can reach is a seamless web of trust. I've seen that over and over again in communities building software, in communities coming together to build conferences, in communities that really come together. It's because they sing, they have this really team spirit, is because they're able to build that seamless web of trust. And it doesn't always happen, and it's work to get there, and it doesn't always stay there, but it's valuable if we get there. Really critical. Not much procedure, just totally reliable people correctly trusting one another. Finally, you gotta have sustainability as well. And sustainability means those principles of community matter in a marketplace. Buyers and sellers also follow those same principles. This is not all about just spending all our free time and not having any money to pay for it. We've all got our responsibilities, our challenges. We've got to have transactions. In fact, love, service, and trust are how you build a professional community of buyers and sellers that lifts everybody. So think about those things next time you're thinking about how do I use Anaconda in my business? How do I build something on top of it? How do I become somebody that can serve others in the community, solve their pain points, solve their problems? It's okay to get paid. In fact, that's how we're gonna sustain the open source that we care about, is by having it connected to our transactions. So again, Anaconda sits on the data. This is our goal. We want all the data to be available to everyone to solve some of these really hard data problems. And there's some technology that has to be built. There's still some array computing, some Blaze efforts. There's still some connectivity that has to be done. There's still work to be done to make this dream a reality, but we're pretty close. And for certain use cases, you can absolutely use Anaconda to accomplish your goals in open data science. You're now part of the revolution. You know, now you've been inducted. Thanks for coming to AnacondaCon. I really want to thank you for spending the time with us and for bearing with me. It's afternoon, it's tired, I know we're ready to go home. Think about what we've learned. But thank you for coming, and please come back next year. Anaconda 18 will be awesome, just like this one. It'll be in Austin in April again. And as you leave, take what you've learned and make the world better this year with Anaconda. Thank you.